All right, that seems to be working. So we'd like to welcome Jeppe Dakin, who is a postdoc at the University of Aarhus in Denmark. And he has kindly agreed to tell us about his newly released N-body code for cosmology, CONCEPT. Take it away, Jeppe.
Thanks, Marcus. So let me see how I actually share the screen. Holy. I guess desktop is the right thing to do. Do you see the slides?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so thanks for having me. Yeah, so I'd like to present the 1.0 release of the concept code. So it's a cosmological simulation code for large-scale structure formation, primarily an N-body code. And the 1.0 was just recently released. So there's a GitHub page for the code and an associated paper for the release. Okay, so a quick overview of, just a second, like this, overview of the what the code can do. So basically it evolves matter particles, N of them, in an expanding box, and then it evolves them through gravity. On top of that, there's a fluid solver, which can be nonlinear or linear. So if it's nonlinear, it's typically used for massive neutrinos. And if it's linear, it's used for all kinds of stuff. Like, for example, you can include the perturbations from photons or neutrinos or dynamical dark energy or what have you. In this way, you can just account for all species, even the one which almost doesn't matter. And using a small trick, you can even make it compatible with the general relativity, which is really, really nice and quite novel. Then it has a lot of built-in stuff on top of that, like Bayesian conditions generation. So you don't have to provide a snapshot or anything. You just say go and it does everything for you. And it does this by interfacing with the class code. So it calls class for you and takes the results and then realizes them on a grid and produces particles and all that. And lastly, there needs to be some kind of output. So it can produce snapshots and power spectra and renders of different kinds. And these snapshots can be in the internal concept format or in the more standard gadget binary format. And so these renders could look like this. So I just recently did my largest simulation to date, 65 billion particles, which is quite a lot. And it looks quite nice. Yes, there was some eye candy right there. So it has a lot of stuff built in, basically. But what I want to really convey in the end is that it's not necessarily much better than other codes on the market, but I really do believe it's much more convenient to use. There's lots of nice little features which make it easier to just get into. And this is mostly apparent in the demonstration part, not in this slideshow part, but hopefully you'll see that along the way. Okay, this 1.0, what does that mean? So the code has been out for 5 years or something like that in different versions. What's new in this 1.0 release is that I finally fixed the small scale stuff. So before it only really gave the right results on large scales due to missing so-called short range gravity. That is now added in using what is called P3M. So that's a gravitational solver, which we'll get to in a bit. And it also now has adaptive time slipping, meaning that particles in dense regions have a smaller time step than particles in voids. So you can, they can dynamically get a finer time step as required. And then of course, there's lots of little fixes and improvements and generalizations which are in the 1.0 release, which I won't go into. Okay, so the heart of the code is gravity, of course. So CONCEPT has three different gravitational solvers to choose from, which I'll go over here. So the most basic one is PP, or particle-particle, which just does what Newton would have done. It just takes a given particle, the blue one, and the force is just given by summing up all the contributions for all the other particles. So just a quick question, can you see my mouse when I point?
Yeah. Yes.
Perfect. Okay, so this gives the right result, of course, almost by definition, but it's rather slow because you have to pair every particle with every other. A much faster way of doing it is to create this intermediary potential or force field. So every particle just contributes to some global field. This is the potential, which goes like 1/r or 1/x. You just solve this potential and get the force by differentiation. And then you just apply this force to each particle. So I've only drawn the arrows like to the blue particle. If I drew in all arrows, there'll be much, much fewer arrows over here. So this is a much faster computation. But it's inherently imprecise because there's a certain width of these grid cells below which gravity is not resolved. So it's very fast, but it only gets gravity right on larger scales. And now finally, the preferred method, the P3M one, is a combination of these two. So M stands for mesh, by the way, particle mesh. So now we again create this intermediary field, but we multiply the normal 1/r by this weird factor, which goes to zero very rapidly for small x, meaning that this is only really non-zero at larger scales, larger separations. Meaning that small scale stuff, like at the cell width, doesn't matter anymore. So that's fine. But then we sort of miss the remaining part, like 1 - this, we miss that. And then we could just add that in through direct summation as before. But because this is only the long range part, so again, this goes to zero for x being small. So it's 1/r at large scales, but it's almost zero at small scales. So we still need to apply the missing short range forces in the vicinity of the particle. So these forces are still adding in, but this one doesn't contribute anymore. Well, we could draw an arrow, but it's almost zero because all of its gravitation to the blue point has been accounted for using the field. So this is very fast, as fast almost as this one, and it's as precise as you want, basically. So you can imagine some region around the blue point that you walk to do this summation, and you can just enlarge that region to get more and more precise. But it's much, much fewer operations than over here for almost the same precision. So that's the new and default scheme of CONCEPT. And so I'll just flash one equation for you from the paper, which is this monstrosity. So it's this whole algorithm in one equation. So let me just see if I can make any sense of this. So it's the force on particle I, the blue one, as two terms, the long range term corresponding to this field, and then the short range term corresponding to a sum over its neighbor particles. Yeah, so let's try to walk through it quickly, starting with the long range one. So first, so we have to read this backwards for it to make sense. So first we take the particles and interpolate to the mesh using some weight function. Then we go to Fourier space. We apply some kernel, which is really just this thing in Fourier space. We go back to real space, we differentiate, and we interpolate from the mesh back to the particles. Then there's some factors, that's not too important. That's the mesh part, long range part. But then the short range part is just this sum over all j, so all the orange points, j not equal to the blue point, I. And then this is just the short range part. So basically again, 1 - this differentiated because it's the force, not the potential. That's why we get several terms here. So that's pretty much it. Yes, so now let me demonstrate a bit of capabilities. So these weights, we need some method for interpolating the mass points onto a field. There's many ways of doing this. So CONCEPT implements these four different methods. So I guess most of you are familiar with this CIC, the cloud and cell, which is the only method that Gadget implements, the famous Gadget code. But now here we have four different ones to choose from. And similarly, the differentiation operator can be of order 2, 4, 6, and 8. And again, Gadget only implements the fourth one. Now we have lots of different ways of tuning the algorithm. And I even added in Fourier differentiation, if you'd like. So you can move this operator in here before you go back to real space and then do the differentiation in Fourier space, just multiply by Ki instead of doing it like numerical difference.
Is that slower? Sorry, just wondering the Fourier differentiation part.
Not all, it's not actually obviously slower. It might be, it depends on a lot of your, I mean, on your caches, because you do require three Fourier transforms to go back, then because you have to Fourier transform each dimension one at a time, which makes it slower. But this operator in real space is quite slow because you access points in 3D, like, you know, this point minus this point, but also this point minus this point. So there's a cross of dimensions, and that screws up your cache in your RAM. Whereas in the Fourier space, you can just visit each point in order.
Right.
So it's not obviously slower, actually, but it should be more precise, I would think. but I haven't really tested a lot about what it does. But it's a possibility. It's in there for you to play with.
Right, because I think Volker cited that it's like performance related. That's why he chose to do the real space finite difference. But then I don't know if anyone ever tested his statement. So I guess this is the only time that you can actually do a fair comparison between the two.
He writes that in the Gadget 2 paper, I think, which is what, 20 years old?
Yeah.
Something. So, I mean, a lot of things can happen. I mean, the algorithm is slower officially. It's like, not really. But anyway, hardware has changed. It's not necessarily true anymore.
Okay, cool.
Yes.
So okay. To some extent a difference between only differentiating the what's it called, the potential where the particles are, and then differentiating everywhere in Fourier space, or does it know where the particles are in Fourier space as well?
It doesn't know either way where they are. It just differentiates the whole thing, and then afterwards, it differentiates the whole mesh either way, and then it interpolates some nearby points onto the particles.
Okay.
But differentiating in real space, like order four, means take four points in each dimension, and subtract them from each other to create a new force point. Whereas in Fourier space, you just multiply by ik and then Fourier transform the thing. So this differentiation operator is sort of local. It only touches a few points, which is what you meant in real space. Whereas in Fourier space, it touches all points. So it has to be more precise in Fourier space. Also, there's only one way to do it. Whereas in real space, you can do it just at any order. So I think Fourier space is more precise.
Yeah, so I'm just wondering why it would be slower in Fourier space if you just multiply with IK.
Because the Fourier transform itself is quite slow. And this is this huge curly bracket is a scalar. Doing this is a vector operator. Do it for X and for Y and for Z. If you do it in here, you have to do this one, the Fourier transform, also three times for X, Y, and Z. So it costs you two additional transforms to permute these.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense.
Right. So please do interrupt and ask questions. That's much more fun. Okay, so the important part of all this really is this green bit in here. So this just indicates that the orange particles to visit is only those which are somehow near the blue one, near I. So this XR is some cutoff range, like imagine some sphere around the blue point. Only the particles within that sphere needs to be walked over, right? So we don't want to pair the blue one here and this orange one here just to say, oh, they're too far away. Don't do it anyway. Need some way to only pair up the particles in the vicinity. And the way that this is done in CONCEPT is using something we call tiles and subtiles, which is a novel method. Is how I try to describe with this kind of overwhelming figure. So I won't discuss everything on it, but a few things. So all these figures are from the paper. So I'll skip over a lot of details. You can read about them in the paper. Okay, so the whole box here is the box, the simulation box, and these round things is supposed to be particles. Okay, so the geometry is like this. The box is cut up into some sub boxes called domains, one per CPU core. So this is how we parallelize the system. So in this example, there's 6 cores. Then each of these are divided up further into so-called tiles, like this. So if you take a particle up here, then this the ring around the particle indicates this XR, this cutoff range. So you can only feel particles for the short range force if the particles are within this ring, meaning that these two particles here, they interact because the red dot is enclosed in the blue ring and the blue dot is enclosed in the red ring, but all other particles do not interact. Okay, so these tiles are constructed such that their width in every dimension is at least this cutoff range. And that now means that if I take some particle like the yellow one up here, I can color in the 3x3 tiles in its neighborhood. And I know that a particle has to be within these 9 tiles for it to interact with the yellow one. Yes, so I don't need to pair this up with anything else. I can just see from the tiles that it doesn't has any neighbors. And the same for the other colors. Okay, so let's try to analyze the system here. So this pink one has these tiles associated with it. And this blue one, or cyan one, has these tiles. And they do actually overlap. So this this pink dot is enclosed in the blue region, and the cyan dot is enclosed in the pink region. So they might actually interact, but they do not. So these will get paired up, and then the distance will be computed, and it'll say, oh, this is too far. It's longer than XR, so don't do their gravity anyways. So that's a loss of computation. We pair them up just to throw it away again. Now there's one further division of these tiles called subtiles, and these can be independent in each domain. So each CPU can decide how finely to divide these tiles. So these are the orange ones. So if I look at this system down here, we again see that these should not interact because the dot is not enclosed within the circle. But if you look at the 3x3 purple one and the 3x3 green tiles, oh, and this goes through the box just to be fancy, it doesn't really matter. They do enclose each other, so they should be paired up. But now if you also look at the subtiling, the orange ones, now it gets a little bit hard to see maybe, but so this hashed green region corresponds to the subtiles within this distance XR from this subtile containing the green point. And correspondingly, the hashed purple region corresponds to the subtiles within XR of the purple dot. And now these hashed regions do not enclose the other particle. And so if you pair up not just tiles, but also subtiles, we can see that that this subtile is only paired with these other subtiles, not this one. So again, we do not actually in the end pair up this subtile with this subtile, meaning that these particles are never paired up in the end. So this whole subtile thing and the tile thing is just a big scheme to somehow quickly eliminate pairs which don't need to get paired up. And it's a mess. But that's what saves a lot of time. If you don't do this, it'll be like a factor of many thousand times slower. That's a new thing in CONCEPT.
So that's like the same as querying whether to open a node in the tree code.
Yes, except here there's no approximation except this one parameter. In the tree, you also have to decide, like there's an opening angle on top of it. So this is what you get from a tree if the opening angle is zero. Yes. Yeah. So it's like a tree, but it's less approximate.
Okay. So it's like if you decide to open every single node up to the external node in the tree.
Yes. Right. Yes. Exactly. Yes, and this makes it both faster and slower in different circumstances, as we will see later. But it's fundamentally different. Okay, that was gravity. Now let's go over how time evolution happens. So this is again a bit of a large figure, but it's not too bad. So as I said before, each particle might run at a different time step than some other particles. So we do this by associating each particle momenta with a so-called rung. So particle I might sit, we say, on rung 0, while particle J might sit on rung 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 and so on. So the momenta are associated with some rung. While the positions are all just the same. There's only one quote unquote wrong for the positions. Okay, so let me see if I can step through this. So now these purple symbols correspond to where the system are in time. So at some initial time t, this is the time axis, right? At some time t zero, everything is in sync. And then we start to evolve the time. So particles on a low rung, meaning usually slow particles, take a large step forward in time in their momenta due to gravity, whereas faster particles take a smaller step, and very fast particles take a very small step. So now the system is asynchronized. Then we can move this clock over here to the yellow state, meaning that now the positions update by going from the blue to the yellow state, all positions of all particles. So notice how we just drifted past this one, but not the other ones. And then all the momenta follow suit and go from blue to yellow. And now for rung 1 and 0, the yellow state is equivalent to the blue state in this setting. So they don't do anything. Okay, move the clock handle, go to green. So again, down here now, the positions drift to green past this one. And now move the momenta to green, like that. So now both rung 1 and rung 0 leapfrogged, so-called, past this one. So notice how it's symmetric. So this the positions used to be half a step in front, both at this level and at this level. And now the momenta are half a step in front. Okay, go to red state, move first the positions, and now the momenta. And again, these don't do anything because the red state is just equivalent to the green state. And finally, back to blue, like this. And now all three in sync, like this. So all of that together comprise one time step of size delta t in a system with three rungs. So when the code says, I'm now done with one time step, the system is really asynchronized. So some particles are actually ahead. Well, they all are ahead for the momenta. And we just keep doing this to propagate forwards in time. But then when we want to output the system, we need to synchronize it. So at some point, there needs to be some wall where the steps are smaller, so they all end up in sync again. Yeah. And of course, the particles need to be able to shift wrong as they go, because this particle might start out slow, one sitting here, but then getting some velocity or acceleration. So instead of jumping all the way here, it can just jump three quarters of the way and then fall down here. So go from this red run, not to this blue, but to this blue instead. And it can also go up. So only half a step and then go up instead of a whole step. Yeah, so that's that's adaptive time stepping in CONCEPT, which is quite similar to how Gadget 2 does it, but I think there's small differences. I'm not quite sure, but it's pretty similar. Okay, so that's the internal stuff. Let's see how it actually works in practice. So this is a power spectrum of CONCEPT and Gadget 2. Yes, so we see that for different times. So basically they look identical for all times, which is very impressive because the spectrum grows by a factor of what, 10 to the 5. So that's very nice. But now to really see it, we need to take one divided by the other to see the relative difference. This is done here for four simulations in different box sizes. Right, so basically it gives the exact same results. I mean, far below 1 per mil, not percent, but 1 per mil at low scale, at low K, large scales, regardless of the box size. And then at some higher K, it sort of fans out a bit to about 1% difference. This is really remarkable. It's so I'm part of some more general code comparison, and CONCEPT is by far the other code in the world which agrees best with Gadget. It's really quite remarkable. Right. So these different curves are not too important. Let me just highlight maybe this one, the dashed one. So high precision means the same CONCEPT run, but Gadget 2 ran in higher precision, which comes down to, as we said before, a smaller opening angle for the tree. And that should agree better with CONCEPT if my claim before is correct, that CONCEPT basically is Gadget in the limit of very small opening angle. And indeed, the dashed curve is better than the so-called standard precision curve. That's very nice. This is all Gadget 2. What about Gadget 4, the newer incarnation? Now I only have one panel for that. Now the scale is much smaller. So it turns out that Gadget 4 agrees even better with CONCEPT than Gadget 2, which is super nice. So now these shaded lines are the old Gadget 2 lines, and the fully colored lines are the new Gadget 4 lines. So basically, regardless of the Gadget 4 method, almost, we now get a very, very good agreement between Gadget 4 and CONCEPT, which is super nice. So like 0.5% difference at the Nyquist scale. That's really something. Okay, so it actually gives the right results. What about the performance? Does it actually run fast and nice? So this is a plot of so-called weak scaling, meaning take some problem, run it, see how fast it is, and then scale up the problem and number of CPU cores in lockstep. So like, from here to here, I double the problem size, but also double the number of CPU cores. And so in the ideal world, the time it takes to run simulation should be the same. So this black line, which is almost flat, is the ideal world, and the red line is the actual thing. So this grows by a factor of 1,000, and it's ideal up to a factor of about 1.5. So it's actually almost scales perfectly. This is at early times, this panel is at late times, but the same thing is happening. So CONCEPT has very good weak scaling. Okay, what about so-called strong scaling, meaning take some fixed problem. And then just scale up the number of CPU cores. So now we expect that the time it takes to compute the simulation just drops linearly. So again, the black one is the ideal world and the red one is the actuality. And it's pretty close at both early times and late times. Not exactly, we got to go out here, but also this is a very, very, it's a lot of firepower to throw after the problem. I think this is a 512 cube simulation. Yeah, so it has very good scaling, both strong and weak, which is nice. but it's not unique. Other codes have that as well. So now this is pretty much the most important plot, I think. It compares the absolute performance of CONCEPT and Gadget 2 for different either box sizes or correspondingly Nyquist scales up here. So this is quite interesting. For large boxes corresponding to low resolution, CONCEPT is much, much faster than Gadget by a factor of, I don't know, 8 or something. Much, much faster. And typical simulations are, I guess, in this region. If you go to very small scales, Gadget is much, much faster than CONCEPT. So there's this common middle ground, and then CONCEPT is much, much faster here, and Gadget is much, much faster here. So basically, if you have lots of clustering at small scales, the tree in Gadget really pays out. Whereas if you don't have much clustering, the tree is really just a nuisance. And then finally, this dashed line is an estimate of how fast CONCEPT could be if we implemented proper load balancing. So right now, these domains from before are fixed in space. So if one CPU core suddenly has a lot more to do than some other, then the other one just has to wait. And that's just a waste, really. But currently, that's how it is. We can compute this and subtract it. So this is the curve that CONCEPT ought to be on if I implement this load balancing. So it could be really quite performant if I did this. So I hope to do that someday. Okay, that's pretty much it. So now for some limitations of the code, why you should not use it. So if you want very high resolution, you should not use CONCEPT because of this slide exactly. If you have very, very large simulations, you should not use CONCEPT either. So like if you have, 5,000 cubed particles, don't use CONCEPT, basically because the FFT part becomes too cumbersome. So it's the same as for Gadget 2. So Gadget 4 has a solution for this problem by doing another so-called pencil decomposition of the Fourier transforms. Anyway, another thing is that CONCEPT do not use particle IDs. So if you want to do something like merger trees, you cannot use CONCEPT. And then it's Linux only. It cannot run on a Mac, which is apparently a big problem for people. But
That's a deal breaker. That's definitely a deal breaker for me.
Exactly. That's how it is currently, at least. Okay, so that's it for the slides. And then I have a demonstration. But before that, I guess, are there any questions?
Did you change in the neutrino stuff?
Not a lot, no.
Okay.
Do you have an explanation for why it is that other codes don't agree with Gadget as well as CONCEPT does?
Not really. So some codes, like for example, Gvolution, it doesn't have short range forces like CONCEPT doesn't use to have. So that's an obvious factor. But other codes, no. I'm part of this global code comparison project, where we try to get the codes to agree, and it's hard. I mean, it can be all sorts of things. It's not easy to get. So it turns, I mean, like a few months ago, I had a bug in this time stepping. I tried to be clever and not do this exactly, but doing some tricks to speed it up. And that, I mean, it's been there for 4 years, but apparently that made a small difference, but it was large enough to dominate this plot completely. So small differences at this level can break it. So no, I don't know why, but that it could be any number of things.
So the HDF5 output, is that compatible with Gadget 4 HDF5 output? Or
no, I only support the old, whatever, Fortran format Gadget output.
Okay.
So, yeah, and then I have this, my own CONCEPT HDFI format. So basically, yeah, I need a way to store the fluid component as well, like neutrinos. So I cannot only use the gadget format. But but you're right. It would be nice to have the more modern gadget HDF5 format as well.
So how is that stored if you save as a gadget 2 file?
Neutrinos, you mean?
Yeah.
It isn't.
Okay.
It will complain and say you can't do that.
Another question is, when you say no particle ID, can I assume that you also cannot run in different mass mode, like different mass for each particle?
Yes, you cannot do that. The way to do that, if you want, is to make separate components. So you can have any number of so-called components and concepts. You could have like N1 particles of this mass and N2 particles of this mass. But you can't have a list of separate masses, no.
Yep.
So and of course, we do need IDs when we actually write out the gadget snapshots. So it just invents IDs for that case and dump it out. But if you then do another dump sometime later, the new IDs will not match. So that's a problem.
So you had four different orders of approximation that you could use for the derivative and a few different alternatives to cloud and cells. So at what level do those affect the error plots? Like if you compare those to gadget, do those just
the things at 100% level? Yeah, no, yeah, good question. It affects it a lot, actually. So these very nice plots I showed later with this good agreement, that is not converged simulations. So I basically run concept there in a gadget compatible mode. So using four here and the cloud and cell method, and then it works out. If I use a higher order method, which should be more precise, I guess, then the differences are, I mean, they dominate the ratio plot totally. So yeah, so these are not supposed to be, I guess this one, not supposed to be converged absolutely. I mean, that might be a percent or more error here actually, but it's identical to the error in gadget.
And for gadget four, I think you had like some order things. Is that for the multiple expansion for the tree?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yeah, so O2 is supposed to be equivalent to the only way gadget 2 did it. And it, I mean, yeah, so the ghostly full line and the actual full line are pretty much the same. So this is the gadget 2 equivalent in gadget 4, and it is pretty much equivalent from the old one. But any higher methods, I write 5 here, but I also try with order 3 and 4. They all pretty much give the same results over here.
Okay.
And this random thing is so apparently there's another feature in gadget 4, which is quite nice actually, that you can shift the particles relative to the mesh in a random direction at each time step. So that if a particle sits still near like a grid corner, then the grid geometry affects the result, which is bad. But if you shift it around, then you can average this out. But apparently it doesn't really make much difference. I mean, can I even find this curve? It's one of these three here.
Well, actually, that would be really useful for me. Okay. I actually didn't realize that you could do that.
No, it can. It's okay. I found that it's most important at large scales, actually, which makes sense because at large scales, your particles are slow relative to the mesh, typically.
But that's only for the fast multiples. It's not for the tree PM method, is it? The random part.
It's for both.
It's for both, okay.
So I guess it actually internally shifts the particles and then fixes the tree and the mesh. So it's for both.
Okay, cool. Yeah, that's actually really good to know.
No, it's a fun feature.
No, because we started doing these simulations where we keep the particles on the grid point at the starting time, and we vary the mass to mimic the correlation functions. So then at first time step, it becomes a bit overloaded because at the boundaries where the CPUs divide up, those particles get double counted between the two CPU domains. So if you're able to shift them a little bit, then I guess that solves that problem.
Maybe. So they all shift in sync, right? So they all shift by the same vector.
Yeah, as long as they get off the group point, because then like once they get off it, then they can decide exactly which CPU this one belongs to. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. Yeah, we'll try it. It might work.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
Just a second. Okay, so I guess that's it.
I think I have a little more general excitement question, which is, do you know what your future short and long-term plans are for concept development?
I do not know. So I would like, I mean, there's lots of things I would like. I think I have like 50 issues on the GitHub page for stuff I would like to do. So, I mean, I would like to fix some of these. So this load balancing issue is pretty, I mean, that ought to be fixed. And we have an idea of how to do it. So basically get from the full curve down to the dash curve. That'll be nice. But there's also lots of features which are missing, which one could build in, like particle IDs, which is quite easy. So I guess I don't have any real feature that I want to like really start working on. So right now, I think the plan is just to get concept 1.0 out there so that people know about it and start using it. And then if I get some requests, which I found reasonable, then I can use that as a guide to what to work on, I guess. Yeah, so basically the hope is to get a following, get some users for the code. That's about time.
Is it user-friendly for like,
yes,
like changing it, like modifying it? Like I get it's really, yes. Okay, so it's better than the older one for like actually putting in extra physics?
I think it is quite modular, and you can read the code. So it goes both ways. So the code is a bit esoteric because it's written in this weird Python Cython language, but it is just Python in the end. So it should be very, very readable and somewhat easy to modify. I mean, we just, yeah, shouldn't be too hard, I hope. But yeah, so there's no actual documentation on the code internals yet, which would be nice. So just have the source code, go play with it, and it's huge. So that's that's like every other code, I guess. But it's not
gadget doesn't have it either.
It's not ideal. No, but that would help.
Right, sounds good.
Right.
So your paper mentioned that you do nonlinear corrections to the fluids that you have on the grid. So could you give a brief overview of how you do that?
Yes, I guess I can. So, right. So the linear method just realizes the fluid at just the density, and then it just solves the Poisson equation and applies gravity. And then in the next time step, it just re-realizes the linear field once again. So basically I just have this density field, which is just linear, that's it. Then I can go one level up and solve the density fields in concept using the continuity equation, which then requires as an input the momenta. Then I just get the momenta from linear theory instead. That's like one level up. Then I can do this, go one level up again and evolve both density and the momenta, which is now so four scalar fields in total, which will then need as the input each other and the pressure and shear fields. Then I get the pressure and shear fields from linear theory. And in principle, you can go up like this in a hierarchy, but the concept only implements those three levels.
So it's all done as a Boltzmann hierarchy.
Yes, it is. And yeah, so actually it is. But there's lots of sneaky ways of, it's a huge, I mean, there's lots of possibilities, because if I just actually do what I just said and use the purely linear pressure and shear, it doesn't work. Because, I mean, at least for neutrinos, which doesn't have a completely negligible mass, the pressure and shear are not actually linear. So I have to somehow put in extra linearity using some, not totally sane sound method. But it actually, it works out quite nicely. So again, I've recently compared it to other neutrino codes, like particle neutrino codes, and it gives pretty much the same results. And it doesn't have these shot noise effects at all, because it's just a mesh. Mm-hmm. So it works pretty good. There's one sort of bug in it. I don't know what it is, but if I have a very massive neutrino, like a half an EV or one EV, then the fluid solver doesn't really work. I'm not sure if it's a problem with the method, like the Boltzmann method, or if it's with the actual like fluid dynamics solver in the code. It might just be that. But then it starts behaving weirdly. But for like normal neutrinos, it actually works quite nicely.
And how easy is this to generalize if you wanted to do, say, axions instead of neutrinos? Just adjust some constants in the shear?
So I don't know much about axions, to be honest. But if they are at the same level of like the same mass, let's say, as neutrinos, you just, and if they're implemented in class, which they're not, I guess, if they were, then you just say, or if you have a version of class where they are, you just in the concept parameter file specify axion instead of neutrino, and that's it. So everything you do in class is just ported to concept automatically.
So all the everything it needs from the Boltzmann hierarchy just gets from class.
Yes.
So if you can talk to class, it'll okay.
Yes, and class use these naming conventions, right? So just NCDM underscore delta or whatever. So just use the same conventions for your species in class, and they will just pick them up.
Sure.
Okay. Let's move on to the demonstrations. You already asked a bit about stuff I'd like to show here. So I'm here in the concept directory, where I have an installation of concepts. And the only file you ever need to use really is this concept script here. So you can run a simulation like this, P for parameter, and I've created a Sydney parameter file in advance, and then you can specify a number of cores if you want, like this, and it will start up and do its thing. So it starts out by running class. So this is class output including different K nodes. Then it generates the initial conditions, so it realizes some particles, first the momenta and then the positions. Then it places particles on the rungs, and it starts time stepping. So time step 0, time step 1, blah, blah, blah. And each time step consists of a short range part and a long range part. So again, construct the field, differentiate in X and Y and in Z. That's pretty much it. Okay, so it's just a small quick simulation. So I ran with 8 cores, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them apparently thought it wise to increase their subtile level to 4x4x4 instead of 3x3 at the very last step, which is doesn't really matter, but that's you see the subtile in action. They are dynamic in time as well. And so the output from that simulation is here. So I just dump some power spectra here and here 2 times, and as data files as well. So just a column of K, number of modes in each bin, the power spectra, and also the linear power spectrum, which is nice. So you get the linear stuff for free, because it knows about it, right? It needs to do the initial conditions anyway. So you always get the linear and nonlinear output when you run concept.
Why is the linear turns out to be NaN at the high K level?
Yes. Yeah, man. What are you asking?
Oh, like, well, why is it not a number? Like after that k value.
Why isn't? Yeah, good. Yeah. So basically, that comes down to the grid size used for the power spectrum, which here is 64, but I only actually have 32 cubed particles. So it reuses the class computation for the initial conditions. So I have, there's some K modes which aren't in that computation.
Okay.
So basically, right. I just, it's because I also just output this, but my grid size for the power spectrum by default is twice as large as I guess most people would make it. So it probes the nonlinear power spectrum further out into K than you might be used to. So this is like twice the Nyquist frequency of the particle grid.
Okay, so it's probably nonsense anyway. So
no, it not nonsense. It's okay. it's not too bad actually. But that's the reason why.
Okay, cool.
Okay, yes. So this parameter file, let's have a look at that. So normally I just keep all the parameter files in this param directory, but that's, I mean, doesn't really matter. So it could look like this. So basically I just define my initial conditions. I want one component, which is a matter component. And I want this many particles. So underscore size, I just defined up here to be 32. Okay, this is a fancy thing. Where's to dump the output? Dump it in output slash param. This param is dynamically mapped to the name of the file. So that's why it's end up in this Sydney folder, because this file is called Sydney. Okay, I want power spectra at these times, these scale factor values, the box size, again expressed in terms of size. So this is a live Python script. You can use variables as much as you want. We need some size of the PM grid and then some basic cosmology. And you can, at any point, you can just, you don't have to specify any of this. There's default values in place. You don't, you can make these parameter files as large or small as you'd like. Yes, okay. So let's make this a bit more interesting. Let's add some other outputs, like you can add some render outputs. So let's see if I can do this. Let me do like this. Yes. Okay. So I just added 15 outputs in logs, distributed equally in log space from the starting time to the ending time for these renders. And let's also make a snapshot at the final time. And let me say snapshot type is gadget. Okay, let's rerun it. Oh. And so one thing to notice perhaps is that it doesn't rerun class. It just, so it ran class last time and it dumped the results to the drive and now it just reads it in. And it doesn't really matter for this quick class computation, but if you have like a very precise neutrino run, the class computation alone can take a long time. So it's nice to cache it this time. Okay, oi. And so the renders are displayed in the terminal, which I find amusing even now after many years. yes, and let's see if it's done. It is, okay. Now go back to the outputs. So that's the snapshot. And here are the 15 renders. Okay. Let's do one more thing in here. So we now just have a matter species. Let's try to add in a fluid species. If I can type this correctly. So I want a species to be everything that we are missing out on, that is photons and neutrinos. And then if you want to make it compatible with general relativity, you need to add this funny species we call the metric. So really what, I mean, it's a bad name perhaps, but it's just whatever perturbation you need so that the force turns out to be the same as in general relativity. Yes, you can read about that in the papers. That's a fancy thing. We don't specify an N here because it's not a particle component, it's a fluid component. We do specify a grid size. Let me make this twice the size of the particle grid. And then we need to specify the order of the Boltzmann hierarchy. So Boltzmann order. Minus one means completely linear. So don't evolve the system or the fluid internally, just realize it linearly at each time step. Okay, that's all we need. Run it again. It reruns class because it now needs the photons and whatever stuff, which it didn't cache before. So it should say, yeah, not all perturbations were present in the cached file, rerun class. And once more, apparently. And it's just the same sort of stuff. Okay, now let's look at a time step. So we again have short range and long range. But now we additionally have this step here, which is now uses the PM method. So it now constructs the potential due to photons and neutrinos and the metric, goes to real space and differentiate and apply to matter. And does this at each time step. That's a new thing. And now we get an error. Some warnings occurred. And that's because, as Marcus actually asked before, what happens when you try to include a fluid and you write a snapshot? It just says, I can't write the fluid to a snapshot because it's a gadget snapshot. That's okay.
Does it still write it, or does it just refuse to write it at all?
The snapshot is still written, just not that component.
Right. So you still have the matter component at least.
Yes. Yes. Okay. It does. So by the way, this every run is logged to the job folder. So just as when you run on a cluster, each job gets an ID, and this ID is exactly just the SLAM ID or whatever you're using on a cluster, but on your laptop it's just a simple number from 0 to n. So if you check out these logs, there's a copy of the parameter file just in case you want to see what you actually use as input, and there's the actual log of the system, so you can read that in here. That's nice to have. Okay, so that's it for running concepts, but it has a lot of other small features which I just want to quickly like brush over. So for example, you can run -h to get help and see that it actually can do a lot of different things. So for example, we have minus n as we use to specify number of processes, or minus p for the parameter file. There's lots of other things in here as well. One of the funny things to do is use this -u for utility. So besides the simulation stuff, it also comes with a lot of side programs which are in the util directory. So a fun one is the play one. So this just plays back an animation from the terminal renders in the log file specified here. So the basically this one. So I find this quite nice, especially for larger simulations. And you can also like ask this for help and see it has, for example, like a frames per second thing. So you can say, I want 10 frames per second and I want it to be repeated. And now you have yourself a nice little screensaver. Yes, so goofy stuff.
If you ran like a billion particle simulation with a like exploded terminal trying to play this.
Yes, so I ran this 4,000 cube simulations last week and I never done anything like that. And this output, whenever it came in the log, it just ran for a minute, just my screen was just red for a minute. It was amazing. Not that useful anymore, but yeah.
I mean, just saving that many pixels in a log file will cost you like, well, like a gigabyte or something at the end of the day.
Yeah, it's not too cheap. Okay, another one is a bit more useful, I guess, is this info one. So for example, you can say this snapshot, which is a gadget snapshot, you can actually inspect that with this utility, which is nice. So it'll tell you it's a gadget snapshot of format 2, and these are the parameters it holds, the gadget header, and stuff about, yeah, its contents, basically. That's nice. I use that a lot when I just have some random snapshot lying there and I can't find a good way to actually see what's in there. Of course, with HDF5 snapshots, it's not a problem. But for these binary snapshots, it's very useful to have this utility. And then the final one I want to show you is the power spectrum utility. So again, the utilities are just whatever files are available in this util directory. So you can say, give me a power spectrum of this snapshot in here, which is again a nice feature to be able to compute snapshots from compute power spectrum from snapshots directly. So now this one, power spec snapshot, is a new one, and it should match this one. And I can believe that they are the same. Yes.
Can you specify like the density of the grids for this estimation?
Yes. So I can say use a parameter file. Let me use again the same one. But that won't change anything. But if I first go in here and say power spec options. Let me see. Grid size, I guess, like this. It should pick that up.
Yeah. Okay.
Did I do something? No, it's okay.
No, I think it said the grid size 128. Yeah.
Yes, I'm a bit confused about why it actually starts to do all this stuff. that's okay. Why did it include the linear stuff now and not before? Okay, anyway, we can expect the data file. Yes, now the grid size is actually 128, and before it was only 64. So you can do that. Okay, just to show you this this quickly. So, okay. So editing the parameter file there was not super nice. So another way to do that would be to supply an additional parameter like this on the command line. It just does the same thing. That's so minus C is also a nice flag. Okay, fine. Okay, so now let me just quickly brush over a lot of these convenience features that it has, which is really, I think, what sells the product. So it comes with a lot of example parameter files. So for example, example basic, which is pretty much just the same thing as I just have in the Sydney parameter file. So if you want to know how to do nonlinear neutrino stuff, you can go in here and see how to do it. That's nice. It also has this example explanatory, which just lists all possible parameters. So this is not very nice to actually use as a parameter file, but it gives you an idea of what is possible, and that's a lot of things is possible, right? Okay. What about how do you install this this beast. So if you go to the GitHub page and scroll down, there's this one line command, which you can just, let me see. Yes, you can just paste into your terminal. And it will say, where should I install concepts? And you can write something. And it'll go out and get whatever it needs and install it. And it needs a lot of things. So in a bit, we'll write it down here. So concept depends on a lot of different things, like HDF5 and GSL and FTW and class and even Python. And it doesn't matter if you have Python already, it will install a new one specifically for concept. So this whole installation takes up like a gigabyte of space. That's how it is. You can specify to use an existing Python or whatever, but don't do it. It's not worth it. Just let it install everything from scratch. Yeah, so it just goes ahead and does that. So just for fun, let me let that run in the background. It may also be that you don't have the time to do this installation. You just want to quickly try out concept. Then we do have some Docker images available. So if you know Docker, you can just write this one command here. And like that, you now have a full concept installation in front of you. You can play with without installing anything. And I guess this is a bit slower, but not a lot actually. So it's quite cool. It doesn't work on clusters. I mean, you can't do this across nodes, but on your laptop, this is actually quite okay. So that's a nice little thing to be able to use Docker, at least if you're familiar with Docker. What else do we have? Right. So I mentioned that there wasn't any documentation on the actual code internals, but that's a lot of documentation on how to use the code. So that's this whole page here, which goes over how to do everything. So I guess the most important section is the tutorial, which comes in a lot of different subsections for how to install it and run small simulations and gravity, different methods, how to do everything. And here, I guess 1 through 6 is like a basic stuff. And then part 7, which is huge, is how to do beyond matter only simulations. So like neutrino simulations and stuff like that. So if you want to know how to do, for example, decaying cold dark matter simulations, you go here and it just walks you through how to do everything. This is a large parameter file. You can just copy it in and see what it does. And it'll explain on the way what's going on. Right, so that's quite nice. It also has a large parameter section. So you can go in here and find out how to do what different parameters do. So for example, you asked about the power spectrum before. That's in here. So I specified this power spec options, and then I specified the grid size key. But you can see here that there's actually a lot of different things you can change about the power spectrum. These are the default settings. And it explains what they all mean. And it comes with examples for how to change it in different circumstances. So I guess the factor of 2, yeah, that's here. Right, so by default, the grid size it uses is twice the cube root of n. So it's twice what you might expect. That's why you get this enlarged grid. Yeah, it also uses this higher order method for interpolation and even interlacing by default, which is quite fancy actually.
What's interlacing?
So you compute the whole thing twice on two grids, with one grid shifted half a grid cell in each dimension relative to the first grid. And then you interlace so-called the two spectra together, and that doubles the precision pretty much.
Okay.
So that's yeah, it amounts to doubling the grid size once more. That means 8 times as many grid points. This is only doubles the number of grid points. It's a cheap way of getting better precision.
Oh, right. So you shift the grid and then you redo the whole CIC onto the
yes.
new grid. Oh, okay.
Yes. And then I compute a third grid, which is the first grid plus the second grid, but rotated in Fourier space so that it all matches up. It's a well-known thing, interlacing, it just calls. It's a Hockney and Eastwood thing.
All right, and since you're doing them one at a time, it doesn't cost you more like RAM capabilities to hold all the grid cells, right?
It does actually.
It does.
Yeah, but you need both grids in RAM simultaneously, unfortunately. So it costs you twice as much to compute the power spectrum. So if you don't want that, you can just say, specify false here instead of true, and it will save you some memory.
Oh, so what's the advantage of it just using like a grid that's twice as fine?
Oh, because this doubles the memory. Using it twice as fine.
Oh, it'll be eight times
the memory, but almost the same precision. That's the catch.
Okay.
Okay. Fine. Let's see how the installation is coming along. Oh, so it's installing MPI. Let me kill the installation. So let me just take a look. Okay, so it installed a few programs already. If I redo the installation now, I can also just supply the path directly. Concept. It should pick up that these are already installed and not reinstall them. Yeah, so this green dagger means they already installed. So these three already installed, and we'll just skip ahead and go to MPI. So that's nice because this process can take a few hours. So if you don't want to, if you want to close your computer, you can just do that. It will catch up from where it left off. So that's nice. This installation script, by the way, if it doesn't work for you, please let me know. I spent countless hours making it general, not the Mac OS general, but general enough to work on any Linux system I've tried. It's one huge bash script. It should just work. So please report to me if it doesn't.
So if I were to make like a change the code and add like an additional file to it, does it have to rerun this installation script, or can I like have the dependencies installed and just remake the main program?
Yeah, you can just remake it.
Okay.
Yeah, so basically it just installs the dependencies in this dev directory. And the source code for concept is in source. You can just add stuff here and it doesn't really matter.
Ah, okay, I see.
Yes. So that takes me to the last point, which is the code language, I guess. So the source files are in here, which are just Python files. But when you actually run concepts, it builds the code in here, in the build directory. So it actually runs off of compiled code. So let us take a look at some, is Gravity is a good example. There we are. So this is the method, or the function used to compute the gravity in the P3M method, the short range gravity. And so what's going on exactly is not super important, but basically it just takes in a lot of stuff. And has a R means receiver, S means supplier, so corresponding to the I and J particles. And it just loops over these, compute their distances, and here we see something that makes sense, I guess. So this, the square distance between I and J, if that's larger than this, it was called XR in the slides, larger than this maximum distance, then continue. And again, these the subtiles are there to ensure that we don't reach this point as often as we would do otherwise. The code should stop earlier, hopefully, than this point in most cases. Anyway, if they are close enough, just update the momenta of the receiver, X, Y, Z, And the same for the supplier X, Y, Z. So J and I.
Okay, what if I don't have the keyboard for those characters?
Like Delta?
Yeah, like...
You just say Control C and you just paste it in there.
Okay, so I...
So I have a cheaty script like this. So then I just copy it from here. But so you're right, but I like it. I mean, it just looks like nicer than this. So it's harder to type, but it's nicer to read when you're done.
That's, I guess, a
preference or not. So anyway, that's a pure Python code. Then when you run it, concept, it compiles the code. So let's look at the gravity files in the build directory. So this one file, gravity.py, gets compiled into all these files. So first, a custom transpiler in concept transpiles it to a Cython file, pyx. So now the same function looks like this, which is a bit more horrible to look at. For example, because my delta from before, is now called whatever Unicode Greek capital letter delta, which is horrible. But yes. So basically, this function is now much, much larger and difficult to read, but you can find the same elements in here. For example, there. Again, the same. If distance squared is larger than this cutoff, then continue. So this is the first level of transpilation. Then Cython takes over and transpiles this into a C code, which you should not read because that's really horrible. So let me see. There. This is the same function now in C, which is not meant to make any sense, I guess. I mean, it's just filled with go-tos and stuff like that. So if there's ever some bug in here, you just give up. But it hasn't happened to me in 6 years, surprisingly. So it actually works out. And in the end, you don't have to worry about all of this. It just happens behind the scenes. So yes, okay. If you really want to, if you're developing the code, you don't want to always redo all these compilation steps. You just want to run the code as pure Python code. You can do that using the pure Python flag, which is fun. So let me run the same Sydney example using pure Python just to illustrate it. So now it doesn't run concept off of the builds, but instead directly off of the source code. And this is much slower. It doesn't look that much slower now. But as soon as it gets to the time stepping, you see that it's actually a lot slower. So right about now. So I timed it yesterday. It's a bit more than 1,000 times slower in Python than in compiled code.
This is for debugging only, basically.
Yes, it is. Or developing. Because you can run it. It's just nice. You don't have to recompile all the time when you develop. So I use this mode when I develop and when I debug. Yes. Yes. Now you're just gonna hang here for quite some time. So let's kill it. Okay. So let's say we actually do make some change. Oh, done that already. Right. So we make some change to the code. And now we run it. It will pick up that something has changed and it will rebuild itself before actually running. Right, so now it's rebuilding the gravity module. And this takes some time because there's lots of steps to do, right? You have to go to the Cython file and then from that to some other files and from that to Cython and from that to C and then to compile code. So yeah, that's why you like this pure Python flag when you're developing. You can also say, I don't really want to rebuild, just run the old build, that's fine. And they will do that. Yes, so again, all of these special flags you can find using in here or in here command line options where they are all the specified. Right, so I think that's what I want to demonstrate. Yeah, so that's pretty much it for what I have. Now, can anyone tell me how to get back to this meeting so I can see people?
You should have a bar on the top of your screen where you can say stop screen sharing. Otherwise, I can force you to stop.
Ah, like that. Perfect.
Do you not use Zoom normally?
I do, but not too often. I mean, it's been, I used it yesterday, but no.
All right. So any final questions for Jeppe?
I guess just with the building thing, like, is there like any particular modules that it really needs to build it itself? Because like I got in trouble last time from the cluster admins for installing all these libraries that already exist. So like which one can I get away with linking the existing libraries and which one I have to let Concept build itself?
You can get away. My screen isn't shared anymore. You can get away with what you want. So you can just specify, for example, Python underscore dir equal and then a path to Python before you run the installation, and it will use that. So it,
okay. So technically, it doesn't need any of it.
It isn't hard, but it uses fancy new features. So if you don't have Python 3.9, for example, or newer, it will not work. And it's just a mess to get all these things linked together. So it's just much easier to do this.
Okay.
But okay, you got in trouble because it filled too much on the disk, or?
No, they were complaining that the installation was taking up too much CPU cycles on the head node.
Ah, yeah. Okay, that's fair. You can submit it as a job, an installation job. That's cool. It's in the documentation actually as a point. Show you how to do it.
Okay.
So you can just basically just put the installation, this one liner, in a script, in a job script, and just launch that.
Or you can do an interactive job and log onto a node and install it there.
That's right. True as well. Yes.
But then
unless it takes more than an hour or something.
It takes 2 hours, I guess. well, no, actually, it's because I use it detects if you're on a cluster and it does anything in serial, not to take up too much CPU.
Put the lights, please, very dark.
So if you do it on a node, it should use all the cores that you throw at it, so it should take less than 2 hours, maybe just 1 hour.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah, this does look a lot more user-friendly than like having several pieces of like gadget and other auxiliary softwares to work together.
Yeah, so nowadays, unfortunately, Gadget 4 is here, right?
Yeah, it's getting
better. That includes a power spectrum as well and so on. I'm not actually sure, does it include an initial condition generator as well?
Yes, it does, but not with class. So you still have to supply the transfer functions.
Ah, perfect. So I'm still one step ahead.
Yeah. what Gadget does have though is a built-in Halo Finder.
Yes, exactly. And actually, a very nice power spectrum. I mean, Concept's power spectrum is nice as well. But Gadgets use some funky features so that it can extract the power at very, very large K, but not just twice the Nyquist, but like 100 times Nyquist. I'm not
Yeah, I don't
aware get exactly of how. I don't get how they do it either, but it looks quite fancy.
I don't get how to believe it either, because like if that information doesn't exist in the simulation, I don't know how you can.
No, I
pull it out.
Yeah, I don't get it either. But yeah, Gadget 4 includes a lot of these things as well. I must admit, and the Halo Finder.
I guess your initial condition generator is out of which, not two LPT.
Yes.
Okay.
It is almost by. Because I insist not to go that way.
Okay.
So 2LPT would be nice in principle, but no one has ever shown how to do it in a consistent GR way. You want to do it with...
Not Cornelius, I would have expected him to do that.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, I should do something about it. But no, I mean, Thomas has thought about it and then given up a few times. So it might be possible, but I guess the conjecture is that it requires some input from second order theory to do it. Yeah, and then that scares people away, I guess. Okay, yeah, so basically, instead, it just it uses Hildovich, but you can start early because you can include these radiation perturbations and so on, which you cannot do usually. So you can just start at set of 200 or whatever. It's not a problem.
All right. So it still does it doesn't do the backscaling thing. It just initializes and keeps the class perturbation.
Yeah. Yes, that's actually a good point. I didn't mention that. It initializes at the time without doing anything weird like backscaling, which is fine as long as you supply all perturbations, like from photons and neutrinos, and B, are in a gauge that is consistent with the n-body simulation. So it currently uses the so-called n-body gauge for this, but we're planning, actually, Marcus, you asked before what the plans were. I forgot. Another plan is to make another gauge for concepts called the n-Poisson gauge. So there's this class of gauges which is compatible with Newtonian simulations. Well, I say Newtonian, but yeah, n-body simulations, which is also compatible with general relativity. Just to recap, they currently uses this n-body gauge, which is nice, but we want to move to another gauge.
Right. Yeah, I was saying, if you have like, say massive neutrino particles as a second species in there, and then or like a perturbative neutrino, like a linear response neutrino, and then the forward growth rate is now different. Does concept still have to somehow source from the class for the growth rate, or like I just don't get how it would know how to add in the non-trivial scale dependent growth rate when it evolves forward now, since it didn't do the backscaling to account for it.
I did not get that. What growth rates are you talking about?
So like if I have a CDM as particles and then like a perturbative neutrino component that's not tracked by class.
Yes.
And so when I evolve forward, the linear perturbations from when concept tracks the linear perturbations from class for the forward evolution, does it know how to track this additional growth factor from this species that's not in class?
No, all species in concept should be in class as well. They have to be. It will not. I mean, it will ask class for the perturbations, right? If it doesn't found it, it will just error out.
Okay, so if I want to add in additional perturbative species, it has to be coded into class for it to work.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah, so basically all concept simulations should be compatible with class, not necessarily the other way around. Yes. Yeah, so it just uses class and just adds in nonlinear stuff on top, basically.
I see. Oh, okay.
Yeah, so we tried in different so you saw before the tutorial, it shows how to do this decaying dark matter, for example. which includes a new species for dark radiation. So that we have to include as well, but that was pretty easy because it's in class. So you just write DR, which in class means decay radiation, or you can use the concept name dark radiation. So I have to, a few places in the concept code say, hey, add this name dark radiation and point that to the DR name in class. But that's basically all you have to do.
Okay.
And we also tried, some other group wanted to include another, two other species, some fanciful new early dark energy, so-called, and a trigger scalar field. And again, if it works in class, it's trivial to implement in concept as well.
Okay, that's convenient, yeah.
Our dinner's here. We'll have to run. Thanks.
Okay.
See you later.
Thank you very much, Jeppe.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'll let you know if it gets uploaded to YouTube, so you also have it to share if anyone's okay. Curious.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, well, thanks for having me.
Thanks for the chat.
Commercializing the project.
That was very interesting. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, good seeing you again.
Thank you. Yeah, you too, Marcus.
Bye.
All right. See ya. Talk to you later.